I've only had two regrets this week. One, letting my friends talk me into watching Tomb Invader. And two, letting myself talk me into watching Fooly Cooly Progressive, a revival that single-handedly sucked out the show's entire personality. So, as a countermeasure, I'll be adding some semblance of personality to this video. I know. I'm sorry. See, Progressive struggles in trying to balance itself as a new piece of media and a soft reboot of the original, but does so without a comprehensive understanding of why it works so well in the first place. It might sound like Fooly Cooly, it might even feel like it's Fooly Cooly, but it's not. While I am getting ahead of myself, the stakes were pretty high for Progressive. From its masterful control of pacing, characters, sound, and animation, the original Fooly Cooly is a treat from beginning to end and one of the best coming-of-age stories I've ever witnessed. But it also poked fun and deconstructed many of the trappings that did, and to an extent still do, make up mainstream anime, often focusing on the workplace, overly analytical fans, and the sexualization of youth in media that still pervade the medium, creating an oddly timeless experience as a result. It can mean both everything and nothing all at once, and that's a testament to how well executed it is as a piece of writing and a piece of art. The same cannot be said for Fooly Cooly Progressive.
Norma, you're a real artist, but love doesn't always turn a profit. We believe in you 100%, but from a business perspective, the board would like you to consider some alternatives. It's just about tweaking the formula to ensure consistency and profitability.
When a show gets revived after years off the air, a commonality most suffer from is a crisis of identity. Not only are the original programs products of their time and environment, so are their reboots. Certain genres and tropes fall in and out of structure with time, such as the once ubiquitous daytime soap opera, but it's not without reason that studio executives push creatives into making drastic changes, some that contrast with the original's tone and theming. Most people crave a return not just to certain characters' plot lines and theming in line with the original, but to revisit the times that form them, pining for an onslaught of episodes that feel as though they were lost to time rather than separated by it. However, when programs indulge and pander to that nostalgia, the product seemingly acts as a lampoon of its source material rather than the full-fledged expansion to it, which can result in some disappointing ventures. Some shows try and find a middle ground and appeal to those sensibilities and their new or aged demographics, but rarely do so without hiccups. Yet when they do so successfully, you'll often find they don't merely reiterate upon the original, but rather they take the heart of that material and push it forward to create something new and worth exploring. Some, such as 22 Jump Street and Twin Peaks The Return, both of which I won't spoil too much because you should watch them for yourselves, go as far as using their prior installments to deconstruct the concepts of revivals and sequels through their meta-commentary. With 22 commenting on the soulless business side of commercializing media through reiteration in one of the most blunt manners possible.
Nobody gave a shit about the Jump Street reboot when you first came on. Anyone with half a brain, myself included, thought it was destined to fail spectacularly. But you got lucky. So now this department has invested a lot of money to make sure Jump Street keeps going. Do the same thing as last time. Everyone's happy.
But the writers behind 22 had larger goals than simple profits, and as the film puts it,
we don't want to do the same thing. We want to burst through our ceiling.
The film accomplishes both tasks while still poking fun at the exploitation of media and branding that conceived it by revisiting the original, both literally and figuratively, to have the characters realize that by doing the same thing again, they've ended up creating more problems than they fix. It's only through acknowledgement and correcting itself that the film and its leads are able to move past the original, expanding upon Jump Street rather than simply reiterating it. Meanwhile, The Return centered around the exploitation of nostalgia and reiteration, discussing how pandering and sequels and revivals can easily shatter the images associated with the source material by the viewer. But both remain true to not just their characters, but the heart of the series themselves, with Twin Peaks even leaving us on a cliffhanger in one of the most Lynchian ways possible, further immortalizing the series for decades while reinforcing one thing. What is Twin Peaks without its mystery? Without such a solid foundation, any structure or piece of media is doomed to collapse because it is the very core of the program itself. Consequently, routinely created reboots come off as little more than shallow imitations of their forebearers, some even being morphed into dramatically different series, like the Abrams Star Trek films, those that targeted more action than characters and politics. While it's not necessarily bad, it did carry a radically different tone and aura about them, creating a feeling of disconnect in the process. Something Star Trek Beyond went back on and benefited greatly from while showing you can appeal to both audiences. Fully Coolly Progressive is the climax of the absence of such a foundation, and from it most of its problems arise. Instead of embracing Fully Coolly as part of its identity, it spends the grand majority of its time trying to imitate it, never willing to take the reins and go somewhere new, instead shackling itself down to the image of the original in its attempts to imitate it, resulting in forced and predictable parallels and narrative beats that it tries to repurpose while also trying to appeal to modern sensibilities, toning down both its sex and violence, opting for a more progressive tone. But it never allows itself to build up to those story beats through narrative or contextual means, caricaturing itself in the process. It has similar monologues, character roles, and relationships, alongside vapid attempts to recreate the thematics of adolescence and commentary on the industry and community that FLCL did so effortlessly. Usually as the butt of a joke, though, while also accepting it as a harsh reality by building off of it and towards its characters. Example being Nauta's dad, someone illusioned with his self-perceived intelligence to the point of overanalyzing his life as much as he does Evangelion, all in his own magazine that he tries to sell to other shops, but that overzealousness creates a rift between him and Nauta. Once again, it's commentary, comedy, and character development all rolled into one. So, should the first two flop in execution, you still have the latter as a firm basis to carry forward with. Progressive simply calls attention to those moments without offering anything of substance, aware that, yes, English localization does sometimes overemphasize Japanese terminology and language, yet it doesn't push back against it, instead making itself part of the problem, all at the additional cost of failing to inform us of any characters or push the plot forward in a meaningful way. Seriously, everything this scene tells us about Ide was already covered in the last episode. This while his work and life in the slums failed to be relevant towards his character arc and, by extension, the story. He is never in a position where his co-workers, resourcefulness, or financial status are critical to how he is able to function around or within the plot. It is merely window dressing and acts as filler of the worst kind. You could remove this entire scene and nothing would change. If anything, you would have a tighter show. Just shove the nosebleed into the prior scene, where it honestly should have been, and devote the extra time to at least making this forced romance semi-believable. Maybe have Ide act as a parallel to Hidomi's absent father, as we learn more about the both of them, so she can at least have some reason to want him in her life. You know, like another show did over a decade prior. But that's something we'll talk about in part 3. Suffice it to say, though, this scene fails in all three categories. Something Seinfeld and Space Dandy, shows about literally nothing, manage to still pull off in even their most minute moments, commonly because there, the insignificant details that Progressive tried to turn into full-blown jokes were used as the setup for future gags. But akin to even its more abrupt comedy, both were reactionary to or causative of the core plot, both sharing the spotlight instead of fighting for it. It's why some of the best comedians tell their jokes in the form of stories. It keeps things moving forward. Hell, that earlier clip from 22 already exemplifies this concept, but also had the added benefit of stacking itself with the addition of commentary. Removing it would damage the film as a whole. And while that's not to say Prague doesn't have moments of comedy mixed in with its storytelling, they are the exception rather than the norm. The majority of the time, they just kind of happen, incapable of being anything more than window dressing, and that's likely because it fails to see those portions of Fully Coolly as statements on anime, but rather as anime itself, the core of which can primarily be seen in how both seasons were developed and advertised. After Evangelion, there was a deep urge from Gainax staffers, primarily Kazuya Tsurumaki, to create something antithetical towards the landscape of anime that they'd helped shape over the prior decades, with OVA distribution allowing for larger risks than broadcasted media, such as experimental art styles from its animators, and the implementation of a soundtrack from an alternative rock band whose music the director really enjoyed. A project of true creative freedom, something with real heart and care put into it for the sake of creating something fresh and new. While there was certainly deeper theming in its characters and plot, it wasn't mandatory to appreciate the show for what it was. Entertainment. If anything, that confusion was part of the magic of discovering it so late on Adult Swim, through shared bumpers featuring comments from other fans equally baffled by it. However, it wasn't so far out there that Toonami was unaware of its theming come their advertisements. The show practically screams it's about puberty, but both concentrated on one thing, King, selling the viewer on the show by playing up both its characters and humor. Progressive lacks that same drive, both in creation and advertisement. No one really wanted it. Sure, the original left questions about Medical Mechanica and Atomisk, but they weren't the foundation of the show. Nauta was, with his story ending in such a gratifying way that those questions were irrelevant towards the overall impact of the show, and largely why fans and Kazuya saw no reason to return to it. There was nothing else there for them. It was Production IG and Adult Swim that wanted a new season, not out of creative reasons like the original staffers, but because they knew it would be a profitable venture. So much so that they greenlit two seasons to air in the same year with mixed reception of both positivity and skepticism. You could tell a lot about the logic behind its inception based on its earliest advertisements, focusing not on the characters and themes of the show like the original did over a decade ago, but the most bare bones idea of what Fooly Cooly was. Robots coming out of kids, put in crazy situations. Set to a variation of Nauta's inner monologue from the first series, something that offered insight about his character, but now iterated by Haru trying to pretend it was a town saying. Yeah, it's not great. This was all while interviews focused more on the people attached to the project. They wanted you to know, it's Footy Cooty with Kazuya Tsurumaki and the Pillows, the key driving forces that helped give the original such a distinct sense of flavor. Names Adult Swim and Production IG knew would get fans on board as early as possible, fighting hard just to get their names attached to the project. It worked too, even after a notably lackluster first episode and a soundtrack mainly scored by Ron, whoever the hell that is, with only one notable new Pillows track. People still had faith it would evolve into something greater based on Kazuya's name alone, this despite staffers openly admitting he only had a supervising role, which in the world of showbiz means he actually had next to nothing to do with it, mostly lending his name to the project while getting progress reports while offering little input. A Polygon interview even suggests he never showed up to the actual studio producing Fooly Cooly Progressive either, hence why he's absent from the video interviews. While he did want them to pursue an all-original show that ignored his Fooly Cooly, the execs knew the series would prove more profitable by exploiting fan nostalgia, meaning Haru, Conti, and all those ironers are back. But such slavish attitudes result in the appropriation of symbolism and terminology from the original without the knowledge of why those elements narratively worked in the first place. An obvious example being the concept of overflowing, a term coined by Mamimi, who never had a Medical Mechanica robot come out of her, becoming the core aspect of the show for when a Medical Mechanica robot comes out of someone, resulting in imitation rather than recontextualization, merely using those identifiable concepts from Fooly Cooly to carry the show forward on 15-year-old coattails. When a good moment of recontextualization happens, it's often because the writers are manipulating the viewer's expectations, reframing elements to create moments of shock value or discovery that play into the core theming or narrative of a piece of media. What was once charming may now be sinister, and that's what makes its execution compelling to watch. It reminds us of how far the story and characters have come, taking those small moments and transforming them into something greater for both characters and the viewer. But because Progressive doesn't understand Fooly Cooly, it's unable to make those moments of callbacks and repurposing work, either as standalone or sequel. The original wasn't transgressive just because of its unorthodox production, but also because it didn't care of what others thought of it, and accordingly it didn't conform to any mold. But it still knew, even in its most random sequences, to always keep its eye on the ball, so come the end it could knock it out of the park with a satisfying conclusion. And that freedom is what allowed it to transform itself into the cultural markstone it is today. But Progressive does care what others think about it, overly so to the point that it fails to carry that transgression with it. It revels in the fact that, if only in name, it is Fooly Cooly, and it is desperate to be seen as such, exploiting imagery and characters when able in attempts to try and recreate the intense and raw feelings of the original via pandering. I know I'm repeating myself here, but it's so intent on those moment-to-moment portions of its design that it loses sight of the bigger picture, thereby using its elements in superficial manners that come off as contrived, all while stripping away any significant meaning they had prior. While the latter doesn't make those elements inherently bad, it is reductive to those components, and that ripples throughout the show's entirety, making itself unfocused, especially in the way it handles its characters in writing. And those segments stand out as cheap attempts at fan service and callbacks, not just to veterans of Fooly Cooly, but newcomers too, because they're done so so regularly in a manner that's impartial towards the plot to the point of questionability. Swinging the bat wasn't said because it sounded poetic, but because it played into Nauta's character and lifestyle while working within the context of the episode, a reminder that he never tries at anything in life, content with simply going through the motions, left behind in his brother's shadow, a baseball player he wanted to emulate so much so that he doesn't fight back against the nickname Takun from Mamimi, a corruption of his brother's name, Tasuku. So it strikes an emotional and narrative chord when he finally takes matters into his own hands to move forward as a character. Without that connection, it just becomes an oddly placed and surface-level statement, one that shatters under scrutiny because it doesn't relate to any of Progressive's characters or theming. Simply put, just because Haru, a character that doesn't really care about baseball, said it the first time, doesn't mean it carries the same weight the second time. It's hollow and makes the show feel less like a passion project and more like the paid obligation that it is, like someone's lying in their interviews. You know, just because. Fooly Cooly may not have been particularly deep, but it had meat. Meat you could taste, full with spices, toppings, and extra sauce on the side just in case. It had all the right ingredients, and while Progressive may have copied them, it forgot that a dish is only as competent as the chef who prepares it, and instead of making a 5-star dish, we got butter on bread, produced by a factory of Terminators. And while sometimes it's nice to indulge in readily available junk food, there's a difference between consuming something you know is bad for you when it has a kick of flavor, and actively consuming knockoff foods that just leave you wishing you'd had the real thing instead, because that's what Progressive is. Hungry Man, the anime, a low-grade take on the real thing, packed to the brim with all the sodium and butter you could want. I know I've said a lot here about Progressive in what's simply part one of this 4-part video series, so if you found yourself watching and wanting more of this, or even just disagreeing, stay tuned, there will be more coming soon. That I can guarantee. But hey, why not follow me on Twitch where I've been streaming Kingdom Hearts lately, often in the afternoons too. The username's the same as the channel, it is simply Bryhard. Maybe there you can yell at me to get my ass in gear and make more videos. Maybe even talk to me about Fooly Cooly and what you'd like to hear in a future part of the video series. Maybe even tell me why you disagreed, as I get my ass handed to me by Captain Hook for 2 hours. I'll see you all in part 2, and until then, much love. Oh yeah, sometimes we play Splatoon 2, maybe you'll join us.